Cave temples of Ellora are the product of three religious systems, Buddhism, Brahmanism, and Jainism, all containing elaborate carvings of gods and goddesses and remarkable memorials of the three great faiths they represent. Although at first glance, all the caves appear similar, each system had its individual style of architecture and sculptures, and Ellora presents the varied style side by side. The excavations on this sloping hill are spread over an area from north to south. Caves 1 through 12 are Buddhist. The next 16 belong to Brahmanism. Caves 30 to 34 are the Jain group. The Buddhist caves are the earliest. However, the Jains were the first to adopt the Hindu architectural method of building temples as a symbolic representation of the mountain. The caves aren't natural caves, but man-made temples cut into a massive granite hillside. They were built by generations of Buddhist, Hindu, and Jain monks who lived, worked, and worshipped in the caves, slowly carving out elaborate statues, pillars, and meditation rooms. We did not begin our walk in the sequence from cave 1 to 34. Instead, we started from the most famous Kailash temple, cave 16, and made our way to Buddhist caves, then back across the Brahmin caves to the Jain caves. According to the three religions, the Ellora caves are a replica or one of the paths to reach possible locations of Mount Meru or Mount Sumeru, which is the center of the universe. We are walking through cave 12, known as Tintal. It is three stories and has eight column facades. We enter through the bottom hall, and the walls are covered in reliefs and the pillars carved with many interesting patterns. There is Tara and the four-armed Tara, and various Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. We go to the next floor. The hall has large Buddha sculptures at each end. There are a row of seven meditating Buddhas in Dhyan Mudra, and the pillars are plain with no carved images. My second favorite cave in the Ellora Caves is Cave 10, in which there stands a huge stupa nearly 27 feet in height and 16 feet in diameter. Buddha is seated with his feet down in his usual attendance, while on the arch over his head is carved the Bodhi tree, with dwarfs on each side. It is the only proper chaitya-hall at Ellora. Chaitya refers to shrine, sanctuary, temple, or prayer hall in Indian religions. The term is most common in Buddhism, where it refers to a space with a stupa and the rounded apse at the end opposite the entrance, and the high roof with a rounded profile that looks like ribs. It is used as a place to worship and chant hymns and prayers. Sound resonates and echoes right through you. It is said that if one visits this cave early in the morning, any loud voice will echo 3 to 4 times, spanning around a minute. While we walk to the other end of the Ellora Caves, I contemplate what makes these caves so special. especially Kailash Temple. It seems a Mahayagya was performed for the rock. There is a Vedic tradition of asking permission from the rock, ground, water, whenever a path is carved through the mountain, earth or river, respectively. After humbly taking permission through proper Vedic rituals, the construction process starts. Chanting Vedic mantras, the rock was energized, sanctified, then taking permission from God and remembering Vishwakarma, the mammoth task was taken to carve the rock. Even while carving, it seems that methodical Vedic principles were followed, because even to this day, when you chant mantras within the temple, the sound resonates, vibrates, and echoes in a peculiar manner, making you feel slowly connected to a Vedic cosmos, which cannot be felt anywhere in the world. The perfection with which each stone is carved gives meaning to sacred symbols of Hinduism. In Hinduism, there are several sacred symbols which are gateways to connect with the Bhagwan. The realization of those sacred symbols in the form of divine Kailash temple can only be done on the presence and blessings of Hindu sages and gurus. K29 is a massive structure and really interesting because light comes through from three sides, which is extremely difficult in cave architecture. The hall, including the shrine, is 148 feet by 149 and nearly 18 feet in height. However, the entire excavation extends to almost 250 feet. The shrine is in the back wing of the cave and is a small square room containing a pedestal with a linga. It has four doors, each guarded by a pair of gigantic dwarapalas, each holding a flower in his right hand, with a female attendant also holding a flower. Two large lions with small elephants under their paws guard the steps which lead to the hall from three sides. In the front is a large circle for the Nandi. The hall is in the form of a cross and the roof supported by 26 massive pillars. I leave the veranda near the entrance and head to the lower cave. It looks as though it may have been a place to contain water. We walk through the slit in the wall to find a cave full of bats. Finally, we make our way to the Jain excavations caves 31 through 34, which are more than a kilometer away at the northern spur of the ridge. We peek our heads in a couple of the unfinished caves, and somehow we end up in cave 32. Apparently, all of the Jain caves are connected by a communicating passage. Cave 32 is also called Mini Kailash and is known as Indra Sabha, Assembly Hall of Indra, King of the Gods. The entrance has a stone elephant and a column reminiscent of Kailash. Close by is a decorative shrine, its ceiling carved into the symbolic lotus. This has a figure of Mahavira, the founder of the faith. I don't know very much about the Jain religion, but I am told that Jainism emerged from Hinduism and is more ancient than Buddhism. Jains were the first to adopt Hindu architectural method of building temples as a symbolic representation of the mountain, and is an excellent example of the amalgamation of the Dravidian style of architecture and the Buddhist architecture. The way Cave 32 is decorated, it certainly has a semblance of Hinduism. What's interesting about all three of these spaces is that they all strive to achieve Dharma, which is a code of living that emphasizes good conduct and morality. This explains in some form how these three faiths coexisted. This was the end of our excavated path of caves, but the beginning of an inner world opening up.